Good morning.
Good morning.
He is risen.
Let's all stand and worship all together.
God bless you guys. Don't be a CEO, all right? So
Love you guys. Matthew 28, verses 1 through 10. Say amen if you're there.
Amen.
All right, and the word of God reads like this. Now after the Sabbath, at the first day of the week, began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for a messenger of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothing as brilliant as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and indeed he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." Verse 8, So they went out quickly from the tomb with great joy and ran to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell the disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, "Rejoice." So they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Amen?
Amen.
You may have a seat. Just real quick. This is only going to set a foundation for where Pastor Greg is going to take you guys. Couple of things. Verse 6 and 7, it's come, see, go, and tell is what they're told to do. Come, see, go, and tell. They're commissioned to do that. That is our commission as well. Come, see, go, and tell. And so when we're hiding the eggs today, make sure you keep the Lord in that one. You know what I mean? Hey, the representative of today, what it's about. Come, see, go, and tell. And then I'm going to point something out for the ladies. Verse 8. The first women to tell, the first person to tell the resurrection, well, they were women. They were there, and they were the first ones to start witnessing for the Lord. Pretty cool. And then verse 9, it says, "Rejoice." So they came, Jesus says, "Rejoice." So they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. If he was not God, why would he receive their worship, right? The fact that he received their worship proves that he was God. He is God. He's alive, and he's well, and he has a plan for your life. Amen? Let's pray for this morning's offering.
I believe this is the perfected word of God. I believe in the volume of this book speaks about my Lord and my Savior, Jesus Christ. I desire not only to read it, to know it, but through the power of God's Holy Spirit, to live it. Amen. Praise the Lord. He is risen. Who stuck around for breakfast from second service, for first service? Let's hear it for the breakfast crew. It is a glorious day, and he is risen. Thank you, Jesus. Turn with me to Mark chapter 16. As you know, we're completing this Passion Week, if you will. We started at Palm Sunday. Saw everybody lining the road with their leafy branches. They saw that there was no fruit to be found. Helps us inventory our own storehouse. Then we moved. We had a teaching on Wednesday. And then Good Friday, of course. We recognized this last Friday that we realized that we buried Jesus on Friday, but as we left, we proclaimed Sunday's coming. And it's here. Amen? Resurrection Sunday. And so in Mark chapter 16, as we review a little bit, if you don't mind, in Mark chapter 16, we remember the angel was awaiting the ladies, and all the men, they scattered. We remember in chapter 14 of Mark, that the ladies followed the burial procession, and they knew exactly where the body of Jesus Christ was laid. And on the first day of the week, which would be Sunday, the ladies came with oils and ointment to anoint the body of Jesus Christ. And as they got closer to the tomb, they started conversing with one another. Gee, how are we going to roll away the stone? Because they were there when Jesus was laid and the stone was used to seal the tomb. And they were wondering how they were going to roll that stone away. Of course, when they got to the tomb, they found the stone already removed and the angel awaiting. And the angel responds to the ladies as the ladies make their way to the tomb in Mark chapter 16, verse 6. And the angel said to the ladies, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here." What a blessing. And that's why we come as modern day believers, and we come and we fellowship as a Christian body of Christ on the first day of the week, Sunday. Can you think of a better way to start the week? I can't. I love being here on the first day of the week to celebrate our fellowship with Jesus Christ. What a way to start the week. I mean, even start the morning. I mean, it kicks everything off perfectly. And the rest of the week is downhill, amen? I mean, it's great. I mean, it's wonderful. I have so much fun in my life anymore, but then I start realizing, man, my life's going by so fast. I mean, before I know it, I'm going to be 70 years old, and the Lord will be calling me home a couple days later. I mean, I don't want to go past 70, right? I get 70 good years, and then after that, it's all burden and turmoil. That's according to Scripture. I'm like, man, Lord, at 70, I'm ready. So I'm kind of doing my jumping jacks, so I get ready to kind of jump. And he's like, "Come on, Greg." "Oh, okay. I'll be halfway. I'll give you a hand, Lord." But we celebrate as we gather every Sunday, the first day of the week. How exciting that is. And this is why we gather the first day of the week, because Jesus rose the first day of the week. See where they laid him. Verse 7, "But go, tell his disciples and Peter." Now, first service, we kind of touched on Peter a little bit. Here was a guy that actually thought that he completely blew it. Peter thought he completely blew it, but he had forgotten that Jesus had spoken to Peter earlier and said, "Hey, Peter, Satan has asked for you specifically. He's asked for you by name. But Peter, I've been praying for you." Oh, man, isn't that a wonderful thing to hear that Jesus Christ is praying for you and I? As Pastor Jim's been going through the Gospel of John, and as he's currently in John 17, at how Jesus was praying, that's really the Lord's Prayer in John 17, amen?
Amen.
I mean, to have our Savior praying for us, man, if you didn't have a spring in your step before you got in here, I know you do now. I mean, your heart is just racing. You're like, "Man, Jesus, thank you so much. Thanks for reminding me. Hey, I'm the one that was up at 4 a.m. this morning. I had to get everything opened and prepared, so don't tell me you're tired." Right? But here, go and tell Peter too. I mean, Peter thought he absolutely blew it. He thought that he thought that was it. He thought there was no hope for him. And so the angel is saying, "Hey, Jesus is going, and you'll meet him in Galilee. But tell the disciples and tell Peter likewise. There you will see him in Galilee, as he said to you." So the ladies went out quickly and fled from the tomb, for they trembled and were amazed. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now when he arose early, in other words, Jesus rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, who out of he cast seven demons. He went and told those who had been with him. She went and told those who had been with him as they mourned and wept. And so this was a really solemn period of time. These believers, they thought the end was here. They thought, well, we thought Jesus was going to be the Messiah, but he's dead and buried. And so the sadness was throughout the land. They mourned and wept. Verse 11, "And when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by Mary Magdalene, they did not believe." They did not believe. "After that, he appeared in another form to two of them as they walked and went into the country. And they went and told it to the rest, but they did not believe them either. What is this attitude of unbelief? What a tragedy. If I could draw your attention to the screen, Luke 24, 13. Luke 24, 13, we find these two men Mark has been speaking about in verse 12, in Mark 16, 12. But in Luke 24, 13, we find these two men, and we find that they were on the road to Emmaus. Now, Emmaus was 7 miles away from Jerusalem. And so all the activity, the feast, the Passover feast and such, that was all being dedicated and, of course, celebrated in Jerusalem. And so after the crucifixion of Jesus, these two men took off very heavy-heartedly out of the city limits. And like I say, they're about 7 miles on the road. They were headed to Emmaus. And if you turn to Luke with me, to chapter 24, a couple pages to the right. And in verse 14, the men were traveling down the road on foot, of course, and they talked together of all these things which had happened. Well, these were the things that, knowing that Jesus of Nazareth, had been crucified and buried, and the stone sealed the tomb. They knew this, and they were very understanding of this reality. And they were just heavy-hearted. And so as they're walking down the dirt road, I can imagine they're just kind of dragging and shuffling their feet, if you will. And they were discussing these horrifying things that had happened to Jesus. And it was truly, truly was horrifying. We remembered when we touched on Good Friday how Jesus was paraded through the middle of town, abused, and just brutally beaten and displayed as a public display, truly as a entertainment picture, if you will, a tragedy. And so these men truly had to be reviewing this, heavy-hearted, hands down, knees bent. Can you just imagine these poor guys just dragging along? And in verse 15, so it was while they conversed and reasoned that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. Now remember, this is after the angel had said, hey, who are you looking for? Jesus isn't here. He's gone. Go meet him in Galilee. And so Jesus had met some of the disciples in Galilee, and now he's partnering up with these two men, leaving Galilee, leaving Jerusalem. And they're on this road. And so And while they conversed and reasoned, once again, Jesus drew near and went with them. In verse 16, but their eyes were restrained so that they did not know him, the risen Lord. Now, a question, how many times during our disappointments were our eyes restrained? Come on now. You know how it is. We can be bummed out. And we can't even hardly see what's in front of us. I mean, we're just so focused on what didn't happen that we truly thought was going to happen or we really wanted to happen. And our eyes can become restrained during our disappointments. I'd have to admit to my own self and admit to you, my eyes have been restrained more than I would desire to admit in present company. Sometimes I can get so focused on my desire, my will, that all of a sudden the covering just coats right over my eyes. And the fastest way, and I'm grateful that the Lord is allowing me to mature in this over the years, but the fastest way to get out of that is I just start praising the Lord. I know you do the same thing. I begin to start taking inventory, and that turns to thanks. I want to be grateful for the things God has done, and also be grateful for the possibility of what may happen in the future.
All right.
I want to give God that total ability to be able to flex and to move freely. He's a big God, and I want to give him plenty of elbow room. Amen?
All right.
Now, drawing our attention back to verse 15, during these particular men's disappointment, Jesus, the risen Lord himself, drew near and went with them. Now, that's funny for us to read that, but there's been many times in our lives where the Lord was truly his presence. We were smack in the middle of his presence. Of course, he's omnipresent. We understand that. But sometimes we can be blinded toward that. So as Jesus literally, physically drew near to these men, not spiritually, but physically drew near to these men, and in verse 17, Jesus speaking, what kind of conversation is that you have with one another as you walk and you're sad? What's going on? Then the one whose name was Cleophas answered and said to him, "Hey man, are you the only stranger in town? Are you kidding me? Haven't you checked CNN News? Haven't you looked at the latest tweets on what happened to Jesus in Nazareth? Are you kidding me? Did you just fall off the moon? Have you not known the things which happened there in these days? Don't you know what happened in Jerusalem?" Now we're hightailing it on out. We're out of here. There's nothing here for us anymore. We're splitting, man. Where have you been? And Jesus, the fun-loving Savior that he is, "Oh, really? What things? What are you talking about?" Jesus has got the best sense of humor.
All right.
He is a crack-up. I mean, could you imagine this crew? Jesus, Peter, the Joker Peter, huh? John and James, a couple of other guys. I think these guys were just a riot. I believe these guys had more fun than anybody should be allowed to have. I really believe they had a blast. And so here Jesus is, physically walks up to these guys. The men's eyes were restrained, so I don't think Jesus was undercover or anything. But he walks up and he says, "Really, what thing? Hey, tell me all about it. Tell me all about it. Pour out your heart." So they said it to him, "The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty indeed." I mean, Jesus' reputation at this time, I mean, of course, he was crucified, dead, buried, now he's risen. But during these three years of Jesus' ministry, everybody knew who Jesus was. And we remember when we saw the multitude. A multitude doesn't mean a handful of people. The writer was telling us the multitude that was laying the palm branches and the coats and the jackets down for the road for Jesus' donkey, they were multitudes. And I mean, there had to be hundreds and maybe even thousands of people. And so the reputation of the Lord was very well known. He was a prophet, mighty indeed. You remember him, right? These two men trying to educate this stranger. But not only in deed, but also in word, Jesus spoke before God and all the people. Jesus was a teacher, he was a leader, and he was a doer by example. The Apostle Paul says, "Hey, follow me as I follow Christ. Follow me while I follow Christ." In other words, the Apostle Paul is saying, look unto Jesus. But through the power of the Holy Spirit, I'm going to walk my walk, Paul speaking. I'm going to walk my walk. And I'm going to follow Jesus to the best of my spirit-filled ability, although my flesh will get in my way, as Paul made it very clear in Romans chapter, the end of chapter 7 and chapter 8. But Paul was saying, but strive, reach for the high calling. Forget those things that are behind you. Never mind. Reach, stretch, agonize. And that's what Jesus was allowing that to be said about him. Obviously, he was God and he was perfect, but he's the standard. Jesus was mighty in deed and in word before God and set that perfect example for all the people. That's what these guys are responding. He says, hey, this is the guy, the perfect guy, the perfect prophet. I mean, we thought this was the guy. And yet he died, was buried, and we're done. We're toast. I have a feeling that these two guys were kind of getting out of Jerusalem because they were afraid that they might get picked off. Hey, weren't you one of those guys that hung around with Jesus just as Peter was questioned? Hey, you're one of his. Oh, no, I'm not. I'm really not. And so was it possible these guys were kind of motivated in that regard too? Hey, man, we better hightail it out of here. It's a possibility. He was a prophet, mighty in deed and in word, in verse 20, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death, and by the religious leaders, he was crucified. If I could draw your attention to the screen, John chapter 12, verse 19. These are the religious leaders of the day. The educated men, the top tier. This is human religion's best. The Pharisees therefore said among themselves, you see that you are accomplishing nothing. Look, the world has gone after Jesus. This is the university's best. Our Messiah, according to the Old Testament scriptures, are here. But we are so foolish and so blinded by our power and position, we have not even recognized him. What a tragedy. This is the university's best. The top. The most brightest. They absolutely missed Jesus Christ. Now, concluding these men's thoughts, in verse 21, we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today is the third day since these things happened. In other words, we saw him raised up, just like John 3:17 said, that Jesus would be lifted up. We saw him lifted up on the cross. We saw him and heard him breathe his last. We saw the spear go into his side, and oh, this was from a distance. We saw him taken down from the cross, we saw him buried, and we saw the stone rolled over the entrance of the tomb. We have no hope. Is that you here today? Are you here this morning, as Pastor Vince said, that do you qualify as that CEO position, Christmas and Easter only? Are you just here to punch your card? Or are you here even knowing that you have no hope because you don't quite understand what it is that's truly going on here? If you are here, we're glad that you're here. Welcome. So you can very well relate to what these men have to say. We have no hope. In fact, we're getting out of town. We're searching for safety. And yes, verse 22, certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us. When they did not find his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. It wasn't a vision. It was the real deal. Angels, God's messengers. And so these angels gave this message, but how funny it is that the human mind is quick to deny those messages. I often think it takes more faith to not believe in the finished work of Jesus Christ, as sent by God the Father, highlighted by God the Holy Spirit. I often think it takes more faith not to believe in the triune God than it does to believe. And of course, God has even given us the measure of faith to receive His grace, and that's a joy. Verse 24, and certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. Then Jesus heard everything, and they were pretty much done, and kind of bowing their heads now. Oh, woe is me. Now you understand why we have no hope. You're a stranger from around here, from somewhere. We're not quite sure, but now we've got you up to speed, so we want to drag you down to where we are. We don't want anybody elevated around here. We want us all to be on the lower level. So now that you're down with us, what do you have to say? And Jesus immediately responds, you foolish ones. Are you kidding me? You foolish ones. Oh, and slow of heart to believe. Are you kidding me? You good Jewish boys, you know the scriptures. You're very familiar with the scrolls. You foolish ones and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Are you kidding me? I know your mamas taught you better than that. I know that. You foolish ones and slow of heart, ought not the Christ to have suffered these things to enter into His glory? Did you cut those verses out of Isaiah? Out of that scroll, out of that certain area? Did you take a pair of scissors and cut that out or something? And Jesus goes on, from the beginning at Moses, in other words, what we call the Old Testament, Jesus began at the writings of Moses, the first five books. At the beginning of Moses and all the prophets, Jesus expounded to them in all the scriptures the things that concerned Himself. Every Wednesday night, we see Jesus Christ as we've been going through the Old Testament for years now, 5-6 years on Wednesday night. We see Jesus Christ in the Old Testament every page we turn. We can't help it. Those of us that meet on Wednesday night, it's great. And so Jesus, from the only writings that these men had at this time, He expounded in all the scriptures. He didn't just take one verse out and then exploit that. Can you imagine? Wouldn't you have just loved to be at that Bible study? Are you kidding me? Man, we'd wear out highlighters and pens and pencils. We wouldn't have enough paper. We'd be writing so fast. It's like when we go to the Philippines and we go and we give our Bible study. I mean, these guys are sitting there pen and paper ready. And there's been so many times where literally these guys would write down verbatim every word that is said. Because they're just hungry to learn how to teach. And we go with the inductive Bible study. We teach pastors how to teach. The local pastors. And so we gather the local pastors. We feed them. And they're so excited to go back to their congregation and teach. They write down every single word. They're just wearing out pen and paper. And so I get a kick out of that, and when I recognize that, I kind of slow down. Let them take their notes. Maybe next time we go back, we better teach them how to do shorthand first. We would have loved to be at that Bible study. Isaiah 53 speaks of the suffering servant. Of course, everybody wants the victorious deliverer first. But Jesus is saying, oh no, first things first. I first am going to offer myself fully man, obviously fully God at the same time. Don't ask me to explain it. If you want to explain it to me, I'll be available at the coffee pot after the service. Fully God and fully man, and Jesus said, oh no, first things first, I'm going to offer myself unto my Father. Fully man, because I have lived a perfect life. Only God could do that. Once again, as we saw Wednesday night, who is it that can forgive sin? Well, only God. Well, great. As I've told this man, this paralytic man, your sins are forgiven. I'm going to prove to you that I've forgiven his sins by telling him immediately to stand up and walk. And upon viewing that, you will know that I have forgiven his sin. And furthermore, you know that only God can forgive. Only God. Jesus obviously saying, I'm God. I'm God the Son. Glad to meet you. First things first, Isaiah 53, the suffering servant. Did Jesus go through that, through the scrolls, and explain the first coming of his coming as the suffering servant? Or did Jesus go on and explain perhaps the Psalms? Maybe Psalm 22? It's possible. Did he touch on Psalm chapter 8? Who knows? Don't you just wish you were at that Bible study? Did Jesus refer to Zechariah, to Daniel, or even Malachi? We can only wonder, because the Old Testament scripture is packed full of references concerning the coming of Jesus Christ. And so that's what we're overjoyed about. And now back in our text in verse 28, they drew near, this entourage, this trio, as Jesus had been giving this teaching. And so the trio then in verse 28 drew near to the village where they were going, and Jesus indicated that he would have gone further. In other words, hey, you guys going to stop here? Great. I'm heading on. Good to see you. Good to know you. But they constrained him. The two men constrained him. Hey, stranger, abide with us, for it is toward evening. So even when Jesus was giving this teaching, they still didn't recognize him. Some sort of supernatural blinder, I would have to suggest. Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. In other words, it's getting dark. It's going to be too much trouble to travel. Of course, they knew who they were talking to, but they didn't. But they were being courteous. They were given the hospitality, which is very common in the East at this time. Hospitality is everything. Hey, come lodge with us. We will pay. We'll take care of you. I mean, man, what a great study. It's been wonderful. So let us now take care of you. We've got some silver here. Come with us. And so Jesus agreed, and he went in to stay with them. He wasn't going to turn down their hospitality. That wouldn't have been right. We don't do those sorts of things when we're in that kind of a culture. Jesus said, okay, great. I'll come and lodge with you guys. He was invited. Jesus Christ was invited. Revelation chapter 3:20. Jesus speaking through the hand of John, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, catch that? If you hear my voice, and then if you respond by opening the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me. Even in distress and confusion, these men still invited him in. Have you done that today? No matter what your current posture is, have you invited Jesus in? I can't answer that. I can only ask. And that's all I can do. Have you invited Christ into your life to make him your Lord and Savior? You have to answer. If you haven't, we're going to give you an opportunity to correct that. And that's exciting to us, and that's what this pulpit is all about. Teaching, just as Jesus did, and then becoming invited. Verse 30, as we begin to conclude, now it came to pass, as Jesus sat at the table with these men, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Now, as he was breaking the bread, did he have long sleeves at the time? And maybe he was covering up his wrists or his palms, possibly, kind of disguising those nail prints in his hand or his wrist. It's a possibility. But he took the bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. And then did one of his sleeves possibly slide up? Then their eyes were open. He handed the bread across the table. Was that the revelation? I don't know. I just ponder these things. There's no right or wrong answer, but it's just fun. These are the kind of discussions we have now around the coffee pot. You remember the conversations we used to have? Pretty worthless, huh? But these are much more fun. Hey, I wonder if the Lord just pulled the veil back, or if the wrists were exposed, or what was the deal? Or did he smile with that dentine smile? Ding. I don't know. It's fun to consider because Jesus is a fun guy.
Amen.
Oh, he's our Lord and Savior, but you know what? I'm telling you, the guy's a hoot. I mean, my face is going to be on the floor when I meet him for the first time. Don't misunderstand me. But after worshiping the Lord for about 1,000 years straight, and he's going to say, stand up. He said, let's go have some fun. And I'm going to be, yeah. Where's my motorcycle? Is it as cool as yours? Those iron horses that we get to ride back on? Praise the Lord. Their eyes were open and they knew him. Can you imagine at that moment? All of a sudden they're kind of looking at Jesus and then they both look at one another. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? We've been walking with this guy for the last 4 hours and we didn't have a clue. I mean, they were just like, whoa. And then as quick as they realized and understood, he vanished from their sight. Wow. I mean, my jaw is now on the table, right? I think I saw a pretty cat. And they said to one another, did not your heart burn within us? Did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us? Confirmation with one another. We do that a lot. Yeah, that's confirmation. Man, praise the Lord. That's exciting. It's fun. Didn't our hearts burn? Well, the answer is rhetorically, yeah. So they rose up that very hour. So immediately they rose up and returned to Jerusalem. Man, they hot-footed it back to Jerusalem. Man, what are we doing? We've been bumming out, man. Our hands have been dragging. Our knees have been buckled. And the writer of Hebrews is saying, Lord, lift our weary hands and straighten our knees. We're hurting. We shouldn't be hurting. We should be having our hands up praising you. Lord, I don't understand what's going on in my life right now, but Lord, not my will, yours be done. Can't we go to the Garden of Gethsemane once in a while and hear that from our Lord and Savior? Father God, is there any other way? Not my will, though. Yours be done. I need a lot more of that in my life. Or what am I bumming out about? Are you kidding me? I eat. I have a place to stay. I've got a beautiful family. What? Huh? What is my problem? I need to get more out in the mission field and get realigned. That's right, Lord. Thank you for that reminder. Get me out of my comfort zone. Let me go sit on a few of these logs as guys are writing down every word verbatim. Or let me cross the United States, the boundaries of the states. Oh, you'll bring me home, yeah. But man, what am I bumming out about? And so they rose up and they hot-footed it back to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 remember Judas had left, as we saw him at the communion table. He had split what we call Good Friday night. And so the 11, they found the 11, and those who were with them gathered together saying, hey, these guys ran in and said, the Lord is risen indeed. These ladies aren't crazy. We're the ones that are nuts. We men, we missed the boat. The ladies are correct. The Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. And so the Lord found Peter. And what did Jesus say to Peter? We find later. He says, Peter, now that you've been restored, I want you to take my word, Peter. I want you to take it. I want you to break it into bite-sized pieces. And Peter, you're a big guy. I want you to take my word in broken bits and pieces, and I want you to bend over, and I want you to hand it and feed my sheep. Peter's a big, muscular guy. And so the Lord is saying, I want you to feed my sheep. This big, burly guy. He probably had sleeves of tattoos on both sides of his arms. Right? Big, burly guy. He said, Peter, I want you to break down the word. And I want you to feed my sheep. They're down here. Take it out of your big, burly hands and hand it out. That's your function, Peter. So he's appeared to Simon. And verse 35, as we close, and they told about the things that had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread. Jesus revealed himself through the fellowship as we gather as a body of Christ on a weekly basis. Several days out of the week, Jesus reveals himself as the bread, the word of God, is being broken. How exciting is that? The Lord is risen indeed. If I could ask the worship team to come up and join me. The Lord is risen indeed, but these men, for a short period of time, their eyes were closed, but now, meeting with the risen Lord, their eyes were opened. Those of you that are guests with us today, we're grateful that you're here. We're always grateful as we open the doors to the neighborhood on a weekly basis. But again, as promised before, we want to give you that opportunity, and we wanted to give you the ability to receive an invitation. An invitation of this sort is simply asking you, would you like to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? That's the invitation. And as the invitation is given, I know that there's someone in here kind of wondering, I don't really know what to do. I know that there's someone in this room saying, you know, Pastor, I'd love to receive Jesus, and maybe I have, maybe I haven't, but I'm not quite sure. And so what I would ask you this morning, if you are that person that the Lord has brought today that just isn't quite sure, I'd ask you just to raise your hand, and all you're doing is saying, Pastor, I'm not quite sure how to do this. I was 13 years old up in the mountains of Idaho. Didn't know what a pair of shoes was yet. A hillbilly boy. And I was walking by the town hall one Saturday night, and I heard this great music flowing out of the town hall. And it was nothing like the music that I was currently listening to in the early 70s, but it was something that was a little more refreshing, and it was very energetic and upbeat, and it just drew me in. And I thought to myself, as I was heading into the doors of the town hall, I thought, I didn't hear that there were any concerts today, tonight. I thought it was very odd. And so as the music drew me in, I sat and I was moved by this Maranatha music. It was very exciting and very refreshing, and I enjoyed it very much. And as I sat through that, what I call a concert, it was wonderful, then this long-haired guy comes up. He He's got a Bible in his hand, and he's got a Hawaiian shirt on. He's got a pair of OP shorts on. Remember those OP shorts? Those were the coolest shorts, weren't they? It didn't matter how big of a geek you were. You put on a pair of OP shorts, man, you were in. I mean, you were looking great. OP shorts were the greatest thing. I was the biggest goofball. But man, I put my OP shorts on, man, I was in it. And so he's standing up there with his flip-flops on, and he is just saying, you know, God loves you. And I've been in a church all my life, every single day. You know, I was the guy that was going, ding-a-ling-a-ling. Ding-a-ling-a-ling. Who can relate to that? Ding-a-ling-a-ling. I was that guy. I never heard anything about Jesus loving anybody. The representation that I had of God was through the nuns that were beating on us on a daily basis. Oh, I'm not kidding. I am not exaggerating. It wasn't good. And I thought, man, this God is mad. These are God's representatives, these ladies. They've got this thing they pull out of some, I don't know where they get it, but it's there. I saw a kid, the kid next to me one time, if he didn't put his hands up to cover his face, I am not kidding. If he didn't put his hands up to cover his face, he would have gotten it across the head. It was a brutal time. I was confused. And then I met the priest. And I thought, here's the guy that just came from breakfast with God. God's mad. God's mad. That's all there's to it. And that was my representation and understanding of God. And when this guy stood up there and said, man, God loves you. He sent his son Christ to die for you. I never heard anything like that. And I couldn't wait till this young preacher, this hippie guy, this surfer guy from the beach would finish, because I wanted to just go up and whatever this guy had, I wanted what he had. I didn't know what I was doing. But I knew I couldn't remain seated in my fold-out chair. And I promised myself, the minute this guy quits talking, I'm going up there. And sure enough, this man gave the invitation, and boom, I was there. Honestly, I had no idea what I was doing. I really didn't. But I just knew I could trust this guy. I knew this guy was going to set me straight. And he did. And so that's what we give this invitation this morning, in a very casual, comfortable way. If you're sitting here this morning and you want Christ, but you just don't know how to do it, all you're doing is just saying, hey, Pastor, would you just walk me through what I need to do so I can come to the Lord? I'm making myself available for that because someone gave me that opportunity, and I'll never forget it. It's as fresh as it ever was. And so if you're that person this morning, just raise your hand and say, you know, I want to have a walk with Christ. I'm not sure if I have a walk with Christ. Don't have a walk with Christ, and we want to give you that invitation to come. Come just as you are. Amen. Amen. He is risen, and it's a glorious day. Ha ha. Join us by standing. The team will lead us out in a worship song, and let's just really enjoy this song and conclude our Passion Week. And of course, the doors are open all week long. If you need prayer, come join us up front. We'll be glad to assist, to pray with you, to love you, and to let Jesus touch you. Let's go before the Lord. It's a glorious day.